In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, my brother, amen. Tomorrow is Jonah's Fest, or the Fest of the people of Nineveh as well. And the question would be, why this fast is coming at this time, and why the change? Because as you know, that the fast of Jonah is added or is taken from another church. It is not originated from the Coptic church. We are taking it from another, as far as the Coptic church. So the question will be when you are going to, or where you are going to put the fast of Jonah in the calendar of the church. A very simple question. There is a theme in the story of Jonah, there is a theme in the story of the calendar, and you will find that the church, through the wisdom of the Holy Spirit, is putting the fast of Jonah in this time. If you recall and follow up with me, the first big feast that happened a couple of weeks back was the first feast that happened, or the first big event that happened, is the Epiphany. And in the Epiphany, Feeder of the Cross, if you go to the scripture, you'll find Matthew chapter 3 is speaking about that, the Epiphany, the end of the baptism of our Lord Jesus Christ. The end of Matthew chapter 3 is the baptism. Chapter 4, which is the next chapter, the beginning of the temptation of the Lord, or the temptation of the Lord, and the Lord was fasting for 40 days. So from the historical point of view, they are back to back. Epiphany is back to back, is just before the Lent and the fasting. And the church is putting Jonah's fast in between the time of the Lent and the Epiphany feast for many reasons. There is two themes that is playing here. The first theme is life, death to life, movement from death to life. And the second thing is the 40 days, or the number of 40 days. So, bear with me, because sometimes it sounds a little bit academic, but it gives more connection of us with the church when we know why things is happening this way. Jonah's fast is coming at this time, that's yet very good. No, there is a very nice reasoning before it, or leading to it. The concept of death and life. In the baptism, there is any death to life in baptism? أنتم الذين قد اعتمدتم قد لبستم المسيح مدفونين معه بالمعمودية. You have been baptized, you have put on Christ, and you have been buried with him in baptism, at the death. And if you take a snapshot of a baby being baptized or a human being baptized, when they are under the water, you think, otherwise they are drowning. You think that they are dead. No, but this is not the end of the story. They rise again in the third time. So now we have death and life, and number three also is being repeated. While in Jonah there is also death and life, because there was a sentence of death on the life of the people of the Nineveh. It was the most aggressive, if you go back to the history and the recording of the historians, and this area was extremely vicious, extremely aggressive. ISIS is nothing. ISIS is nothing towards, if you are comparing them with what was happening in the time of Nineveh. So Jonah was scared to death to go. We always think, God is sending you to preach, and why you are not going? Why you are not obeying? Why you are not accepting the word of God? And no, it was very, very scary time, a very, very scary community that Jonah is going to go. And he is going with a message. After 40 days, the city will be destroyed. You are telling people who are that aggressive, people who are telling them you are going to die after 40 days. The first thing will come to remind us, to just kill you. That's why he was extremely scared. And he said, not Nineveh, just send me anywhere else, and that's why we know the story of Jonah. So death and life is happening in the epiphany. We are baptized, but Munim Mahrum, we are buried with him in baptism, and we rise also with Christ in baptism, and this happens in 3 days. There was a death sentence on the people of Nineveh, and through the calling of Jonah in this time, God removed the death sentence and said, you know what, I'm going to give you life because you have accepted or you have heard my word. So what has this to do with the Lent? The Lent is also death and resurrection. The end of the Lent is the cross and the beginning, the end of after 3 days again. So we have 3 times baptism. We have 3 days of Jonah in the belly of the whale, and we have 3 days after the death of the Lord. So death, this is a very clear. But what has this to do with me and each one of us? This is the season. Jonah's fast is just a bell. The bell is ringing. It's telling us, you know what, the Lent is coming. The Lent is close by. And we need a reminder for the Lent. There are already there are 7 weeks in the Lent. We don't need a reminder. And there is even a week, the week of preparation. So we need that much of a reminder. This is too much. No, because it is death or life. It is movement from death to life when we live a life of repentance. And that's why this is the season of death, the season of moving from death to life, or the season of living a life of repentance in this time. There was a Christian boy who was speaking with his teacher, and the teacher was an atheist. And the Christian boy was telling, so the teacher was telling the boy, do you really believe that God, that what happened in the Bible? He told them, yes, it is always true. He told them, do you really believe that a man is being swallowed in the belly of a whale? This is unbelievable. He told them, yes, if the Bible, if the boy is telling the teacher, if the Bible is saying this, then definitely this happened. So he told them, how can you prove? So the boy is telling him, is telling the teacher, you know what, when I go to heaven, I will meet Jonah, and I will ask him, how did it happen? So the teacher is responding to him, and he told him, but what if Jonah is not in heaven? So the boy told him, you ask him. So it is the simplicity of the faith. Simplicity of the faith. But we keep going back and forth, and I mean, we'll all just go many times. We find specifically people who they don't know much about the Bible, and they keep judging the Bible or saying, oh, this is criticizing the Bible, this is not true. And just ask yourself one question. Did you read the Bible? Just a very simple question. You are judging or you are criticizing something that you have no clue about. Just read the Bible, start with reading the Gospel of St. John, and put in your heart one thing. Tell God, show me the truth, I'm searching for the truth. Just have this idea. Read the Gospel of John and pray one prayer. Show me the truth, O Lord, I need to know the truth. So it is not coincidence that the church, through the work of the Holy Spirit, is putting Jonah in the middle between the Epiphany and the beginning of the Lent, because it is tying both. It is tying or linking death and life in Epiphany. It is linking physically the two events that is happening. The death and life message in the Epiphany is also in the fast of Jonah. It is also in the Lent, and it is also in the resurrection, or the cross and the resurrection. So what shall we do as this time of the season of the fast of Jonah? It is starting tomorrow. We have for all the churches, as far as I report, they have 4 liturgies, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and the last liturgy is the Passover of Jonah, and the Passover also is a death to life. The agent when he was passing on the houses of the children of Israel, when he sees the blood, he passed over. If he didn't see the blood, they will die. And when he sees the blood will be a reason for them to move from death to life. So, Jonah, remember four things in the name of Jonah. J for Jesus type. J for Jesus type. He is the type of Jesus. Because as it says very clearly, that as Jonah stayed in the belly of the whale 3 days and three nights, the Son of Man will be staying in the tomb for 3 days and three nights. He is the life of Jonah is a symbol. He himself is a symbol of Christ in many, many, many things. As Jonah was in the belly of the whale, and he descended in the belly of the whale, you will find Christ also descended to Hades, and he stayed, and he took the soul of those who are waiting on the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. So the acronym Jonah, he is a Jesus type. He is pointing to Jesus. He is a symbol of Jesus. You can see Christ in the life of Jonah big time. Do people see anything related to Christ in our life? Do they see the peace of the Lord in you? Do they see the fruits of the Spirit in you and me? Or what they see really? So, for those who are speaking, J for
Jesus
type O, obedience. You will find a very remarkable event in the time of Jonah. Jonah, he disobeyed everything else in the story, obeyed from the sea, obeyed the whale, obeyed the sailors who were atheists. They obeyed, they didn't believe in God. They obeyed the 120,000, including the animals, including the king of Nineveh. All of them obeyed, but the one who did not obey was only Jonah. And I am not in a position, this is a great prophet, he's a type of Christ, as we said. We are not maybe Jonah, because any one of us, if he is in his position, would have done the same. But it takes from God a very little amount of strong storm that the sailors believed. It took from the way, message from God telling the way, we go and do this with Jonah. It took from the children of, or the people of Nineveh, 6 words: after 40 days, the city will be destroyed. It took from Jonah a lot of time. It took him that he would go inside of the belly of the whale. He stayed 3 days almost between death and life, and he doesn't know what's going to happen. So God is sending messages for all of us to respond, whether to respond by a storm, whether to return by a fire messages, whether to return by being swallowed by a wave, whether to return by the rule is that we return. But how God is sending the message, this is in the hands of God, based on how sensitive we are. Based on how sensitive we are, the more we are sensitive, the more we get it easily. We don't need to go all the way to the belly of the whale to get it. So J for Jesus type, O, obey, and never lose hope. Never lose hope for the salvation of people that vicious like the people of Nineveh. Never lose hope for people for the salvation of even Jonah himself, as it was tough. He was rebelling, fleeing, no. And you say, when you see people around us this living this life, you would say, it is very tough, the salvation of most people. Never lose hope, because God is going to reach to everyone, but it depends on how sensitive we are to respond to Him. So J for
Jesus,
is Jesus type. O, obey, and never lose hope. A, asceticism. It is the time of fasting without eating any food. The Imam kept the breakfast.
fast.
What does it mean, break fast?
Break fast.
Breaking the fast. It's very simple. Breaking the fast. So when we are fasting, we don't have
to break it.
To break it, which is we don't have breakfast. As simple as that. Fasting, if you are busy and you are in school, I totally understand that. I get it. I'm not telling you to cancel your schedule and come to church and all the time you need. No. I'm just telling you, in this time, if you can commit to one liturgy in any of the churches and go and the plan that you will take communion and you will fast in this time with asceticism, with might be mindful of that this time is a time that I will tell my body stop, tell my mind don't think much of the food, tell myself, you know what, this is a time that I can connect more with God. So G for Jesus Christ, obey and never lose hope, as asceticism, and the last one is humble yourself. The problem of many people, many families, many churches, any place you find division, look at the حيصل غيرة والتحزن وهناك التشويش وكل أمر ربي. Where there is envy and jealousy, there is confusion and everything bad. Where there is envy and jealousy, there is confusion and everything bad. Envy and jealousy will come from pride. And when you search, if you also return back to one of the sayings of Pope Jonah, الزاد أساس المشكلات. The pride, the self, ourself, or our ego is the reason for all the problems. The more we humble ourselves, I will give you an example. A birthday party, a gathering, a wedding, a baby shower, whatever, and you are not invited. And you saw the picture on Facebook that they are having fun, and you were not there. And I was not invited. What is the response? You pick up the phone and you think, how dare you do this in gathering, and they didn't invite me, why are we doing this, and I have invited you at this time, and you go crazy, and people go crazy for stuff like this. If we humble ourselves and say, no, I didn't miss anything, and it is not going to add to me anything, it's no big deal. Maybe they forgot, maybe I'm not worthy, maybe, yeah, it can hurt, I can get this, because you feel that you are missing out or are left out. But when we humble ourselves, it doesn't bother us. It doesn't make a difference. It is not a big deal. Just say, no, it's no big deal. Maybe the people who attended were more deserving to the party more than me. Maybe I didn't, whatever, when you put the blame on yourself, you are just coming closer to God. This puts you on your knees, you pray more, you connect with God more, and we let go more. But because of our pride, our reaction is multiplied by 10. Our frustration, our anger, our resentment, our bitterness, our sourness, the sourness in the relationship, it's no big deal. Somebody entered and didn't say hi to me, it's no big deal. Somebody did not give you the respect and did not call you doctor for that, or PhD for that, or master's degree for that. It's no big deal. So, it's not going to add to you anything, it's not going to take from you also anything. But as a human being, sometimes it just hits us, and including myself. But the more we are humbling ourselves, I will tell you a story of a priest in the Coptic church that, because of a humble priest, a youth in the Coptic church completely away from God, because of a humble priest, he returned back to God. This priest was living his life completely before Christ, is completely away from God. And doing like whatever the youth are doing in his time. Everything you can think of, he was doing. And this youth, he had a major turn around in his life. He came closer to God, started praying, attending the church, reading the Bible, going to the monastery. Wow, what's going on? A lot of changes is happening. And after a while, he was nominated for priesthood. After a while, he was ordained as a priest. And one time, one of the people who knows this priest from the very old times, and he went and he told him, can you tell me what is the turning point in your life? I mean, we know you're from the get-go, we know you're from a long time, but you're completely away from God. He said it was this trip to this beach place. So he asked him what was happening. He had a priest of almost 65, 70 years old, and this priest was very kind and very nice, and they started breaking a room, getting into his room and making fun of the stuff that he's doing, and putting shaving cream on his clothes. I mean, they messed around big time. And a woman knew, and he noticed, and he didn't do anything. And they arrived all the way to the arrives to the place of the church. The trip is ending, and Abuna is standing in front of the stairs of the bus, and all the people in the trip are going, I leave. And this guy was being like the gang leader, was being doing all of this to that old Abuna. Abuna looked to him in his eyes and he gave him a hug. And he didn't prevent him, he didn't do anything. So this Abuna was not hungry, he would have taken this young man, disciplined him, and removed him and cast him out of the church. This night, this youth couldn't sleep. He couldn't sleep. He said, you know, after all what I have done to this priest, after all of that I personally have made fun of, I have put him down, I have ridiculed him. How come he is giving me this hug, and how come he is a humble man? When you humble yourself, you can bring and capture and bring more people to God. May God give me and give each one of us the good start that Jonah's fast tomorrow. Jamie, for as Jesus like, all for obedience, and never lose hope, be a simple saint like each. Humble yourself, hope is the glory forever and ever.